Championship Tour Europe Winter Preliminaries. I'm Robert Worthen Wing, once again joined on the desk by Liquid Savige and Brian Kibler. Guys, we just witnessed a really intense series here, and we got one more of our finalists heading to the Europe Top 8 Championship. And guys, who's going to join them? We have one more upper bracket. One more upper bracket match remaining, and we're going to find out between these next two competitors who's going to be the final person to qualify from the upper bracket.
Can I make guesses?
Question asked this time. Go ahead.
Yes. I'm going to say Colemon. I'm actually really excited to see a little bit more unknown player bring a Rogue deck, because Rogue is the most skill-intensive deck, in my opinion, in the entire game, in competitive play. And we have only seen players like Thais and Ostkaka be brave enough to bring it here. And Colemon is bringing that kind of like a same type of lineup, potentially, which is the Freeze Mage. Maybe even Patron, looking at the other class that he's bringing. And I'm really excited to see an unknown player play Rogue.
Yeah, our British fellow casters here, Colobon was actually a name that, when looking through the remaining players, they actually were quite familiar with. He's not a player that I personally have any real knowledge of, other than the sort of research we did earlier. But he is a player who has had a great deal of success on the ladder and in smaller tournaments before this.
Right, Colomon's not actually an unfamiliar name. He's a player who's been around since 2014, so you know, way back in the closed beta days, like, he's played a bunch. His opponent, however, Diggin, a little bit flying under the radar, but he's a player who actually arrived at this point by finishing top 50 in North America, I believe, in the January season. So he's no, obviously, slacker himself. So I think it's going to be a great series, and we will see who will be joining. I believe it was Pokervok, Nick Slay, and Dr. Hippie as the other three people going to the top 8.
Yep, and here we see the bans. Colemon taking out that Druid. He could have also banned the Warrior. Druid, that might mean that Colemon's Warrior is control and not patrons, like I guessed.
Yeah, I really like the Druid ban. As I said yesterday, if I were coming to a Hearthstone tournament these days, I think that is the class I would probably just look to ban out. It has the highest number of shenanigans to my fury, right? It's just see the wild growth, you see the innervates, the cards come out too soon, you have the combo to top it off. So I definitely do not disapprove of Colemon's ban. And Diggin has chosen to ban Colemon's Warlock. So again, another wide range, versatile class. So again, these bans aren't super surprising.
It's interesting, cause at this stage of the tournament, the players quite possibly have a little bit of information about what to expect from the other players. They may be, you know, in communication with other players who may be at the Fireside Gathering where they're playing, or, you know, just heard bad beat stories over Twitter or something. It's like, oh, this guy's playing this. So the bands at this point can have a little bit more sort of information behind them rather than necessarily just speculating off of the class composition of the opposing lineup.
At this point of the tournament, it's quite possible that there's even some mind games going into the bans, expecting a certain ban from your opponent because they are so far in the tournament.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, there's a lot of statistics that are available through, you know, the Battlefy page we've been talking about. And, you know, it's possible that these players have been doing a little bit of their research there and may have a bit of extra information. But here we are into the game. Diggin, it seems, is playing a Paladin deck to start, and Colemon with that Rogue.
Yeah, not super surprising to see Diggin open up with that Paladin. Paladin, very strong class to begin with.
Though something that is a little bit surprising is the composition of actually both of these players' hands. The two Abusive Sergeants and Owl in Diggin's hand, those are all cards that are a little bit uncommon if he is playing Seeker Paladin. It's possible that we are seeing that more aggressive Paladin deck.
Yeah, last time we saw double Abusive Sergeant from a Paladin deck, it was indeed not a secret Paladin deck, but instead of the more face type. And here we see the South Sea deckhand, so almost certainly Diggin is not playing secrets, but instead of playing a very aggressive face Paladin.
Some of the information we actually got from Diggin is that he did practice with Bunny Hopper, who we saw playing an aggressive Paladin deck as well. So it's not really surprising that he would also be playing a deck of that ilk. And there's an interesting draw from Colemon right there.
Yeah, indeed. Gadgets on Auctioneer. What year is this? Oh, it is 6 mana, so we are at 2016. It's really amazing to see that he chose to bring this deck, and he's looking at double preparation right now. So if he finds solid plays for the turns leading up to the Auctioneer and is able to hold on to those preparations, that's going to be extremely powerful.
Well, Diggin is not going to give him much time. He has a very aggressive hand, starting with Minibot into likely Minibot and then Deckhand, Argent Squire, all kinds of pressure.
Yeah.
It's actually something I want to point out. Back in the day, when Miracle Rogue was at its height, I know this was a deck you played a bunch of. You were really one of the best players I ever saw play this deck at its height of power. The way you beat this deck was just to go face. You just did not give them chances to get to the Gadgets and Auctioneer, the Conceal. You just did not allow it. You were on that face plan, and that's actually when Face Hunter really rose up as being kind of a popular deck. So I think Diggin lines up pretty well into this.
I think so, too. Diggin being a face paladin player, or like aggressive paladin player instead of the secret paladin, is definitely better than if he was playing secrets against this particular deck.
And Coloman, with breaking the shield off that first mini bot, doesn't really have a way to finish it off. He has a kind of a clunky hand. He has a pair of saps, not really what you want to be using on two drops, but it actually may be his best option here, is to just kind of slow the bleeding a little bit and send one of those mini bots back to the hand.
Yeah.
Otherwise, he really can't interact with this board. He can attack the mini bot for one and re-dagger. It's a really rough spot for him.
He doesn't have anything else to play. Antique has to go for one of the saps here. There's no poison, no nothing really to for next turn either, so I would expect to see a sap here.
That said, I do want to point out that once Coloman gets to that Gadget Zane Auctioneer turn, two preparations means he's going to go off. He's going to draw
divine
cards.
Favor means Diggin is going to go right back up at him.
Diggin's like, thanks for doing the work for me, buddy. Thanks for handling my light work.
That Auctioneer's bargaining was not as good as he thought.
Yeah, that is definitely one of the hallmark staples of the more aggressive Paladin deck, is that Divine Favor, which allows them to just get right back into the match, and you only need to run one of them.
Oh, wow. So Coloman decides to take it slow, try and conserve his saps here. And to be fair, it's possible that he doesn't really have any real intel on Diggin's deck. We've talked a little bit about, you know, how perhaps these players have done a little bit of research, but it's also possible that they just didn't have information about the decks their opponents were playing. He may think he's up against a more sort of traditional secret mid-range-ish paladin.
Yeah, and Sir Finley asks, who's up for an adventure? I don't think Coloman knows just what kind of adventure this is going to be.
Now he knows, yeah.
We actually just saw a little bit of a smirk there as the abusive surgeon comes down. It's like, oh, maybe I didn't just want to take 4 damage breaking Divine Shields. And Eviscerate, again, not what Coloman is looking for. He has a handful of cards that if he gets to the mid and late game, he can start really going off with Auctioneer. He's not going to get to the mid and late game. This is a game that's going to be ending quick.
Yeah, almost certainly Coloman just now figured out what kind of paladin he's up against, because saving saps against this type of paladin, it's probably unnecessary. But now he knows that Finley Mergleton and also the Arching Squire with the Abusive Surgeon, there's no doubt in his mind anymore.
Right, we've seen Coloman's face now for the past minute and a half has been stuck in a perpetual state of deep sigh followed by, yep.
It's sort of a combo smirk grimace, I think, is really. And now it looks like he may be sapping or eviscerating one of these mini-bots that he's actually already taken 4 damage from, including attacking into it. And yeah, he's just going to go ahead and use that sap, use it eviscerate, and, you know, not the best use of his resources overall, but I think his best chance to stay alive.
Definitely. I like seeing the sap there. Finally, he could have also done it last turn, but like it was mentioned that he did not know that, so.
And from Diggin's perspective, you have to think that when you see this, it seems unlikely your opponent has much that he can use to effectively clear your board. He probably would have played something like Deadly Poison Blade Flare in that turn. So you feel pretty safe, I think, just kind of playing everything out to the board and just forcing your opponent to rely on the top of their deck.
Yep, and Coloman really looking for either Blade Flurry or a Fan of Knives from the top. That would help a lot, even though there are those Divine Shields, so he wouldn't still be able to get a full clear.
All right, well, there's a fan.
Yeah, that definitely helps. Yeah.
We actually have, there's the Azure Drake here too, so if he wants to get the 2 damage fan, he can play Azure Drake and prep into fan, which I think is what we might see.
Yeah, he has to do it. There's no way he can hold on anymore. He's already down to 14, and okay, this is interesting. Is he going to pop the Divine Shield from the minibot maybe first?
Yeah, I imagine he will.
Yeah.
This is still putting him in dangerous territory. Both those Argent Squires do survive thanks to the Divine Shield, and The oh-so-resilient Finley Mergleton will also survive, and now Diggin has the opportunity to reload with that Divine Favor.
That's right, and he's going to get quite a few cards with it. If he picks up a cheap card that he can, 2 or less mana, he will also be able to play first, and there we go.
So yeah, we have a 3-mana better than Sprint, draws 5 cards off a Divine Favor here. And we see, once again, a little bit of a grimace in Coloman's face there as Diggin picks up pretty much an entire full hand.
A Might be looking at that value muster with the knife juggler there in the next couple turns. But Coleman does have Sludge Belcher, and this is obviously not something we saw in the original Miracle Rogue deck, where it was a kind of like the big meaty taunt to just kind of hold the lines. But I definitely like it in this deck, with as susceptible as it is to these just straight up aggressive decks.
Yeah, it's definitely a good card to have in this matchup, but in this particular situation, it might be too little, too late.
It is worth noting, though, that the Paladin deck doesn't necessarily have that many ways to deal damage directly. It really relies on having minions on board and in many cases, preserving those minions with things like those Divine Shields. The Sludge Belcher, if it's able to come down, right now it actually is going to pretty much stop Diggin's entire board, and he's going to rely on something like Knife Juggler or even the hero power with Fire Blast to actually end the game.
Do you also maybe consider doing something like Sludge Belcher, perhaps sap a Lepronome or something, just to get some damage off the board, or is it just giving up too much?
It's a little bit too much, I think, because it's so easy to play back, and it's possible that Deacon is also playing Pilot of Shredders. That's a common card in the Acro Paladin list, too. They're kind of topping off the curve.
Oh, and there is Iron Beak Owl. It is actually going to be enough for lethal. Taking away the taunt, those minions get to go face, and then Consecration will just finish things off.
That hoot hoot is the most terrifying sound to the Sludge Belcher.
Yeah, Sludge Belcher has you know, he does a little bit of burping, you know, and then I think, and the owl's just like, dude, come on, have some manners here.
Please control yourself. So unfortunately, that's not going to go the way Coleman wanted to, and really he had the misfortune of running into one of the only. Like, there weren't that many pure aggro Paladin decks in the tournament,
well,
so.
I mean, we've seen Diggin here, and he prepared, as he said, with Bunny Hopper.
Right.
And the two of them with this aggressive Paladin deck have both made it quite far. Bunny Hopper, we just saw him narrowly lose to make the top eight. He's still in the lower bracket. And now Diggin playing for his spot in the championship. They've definitely found something with this deck, I think.
Yeah, I think that it's actually a really good meta call right now to be bringing that deck. It's not something that I would have considered myself before the tournament, but now that I've seen the Acro Paladin in action, I'm actually quite convinced that these guys made an excellent choice to bring it.
And I think that in many cases, lots of the decks people do bring to try and beat Secret Paladin, things like this Rogue deck, for instance, that's, you know, very strong against the somewhat slower mid-range-ish versions of Secret Paladin. You know, it suffers, as we saw here, when it's just has much more pressure on it, put much more quickly.
Right, a lot of these decks that are really popular right now are very much board-centric, and how they win is definitely from the board, like wrestling, control with trades, playing these big buffs, and decks like Facehunter, decks like Aggro Paladin, they just kind of say, no, I'm not really interested in playing that game. A lot of my minions have Divine Shield or something that just makes them sticky. You're going to have to work twice as hard to clear them, and we saw just how successful it was, especially against Rogue, where Divine Shield has always really shined anyway.
It's also worth noting that most people probably will assume when they see a Paladin, the opposing lineup, that it's a Secret Paladin.
Right.
And they will have their pick and ban strategy based around that expectation. And it's possible that they gain a bit of an edge by their opponent thinking, okay, well, I'll have my decks that are good against Paladin, and I'll ban this. So actually, your deck isn't good against this kind of Paladin.
Right. I can't quite remember what cards he kept in his starting hand, but that's also, if you see a Paladin and you don't know what it is, you're definitely going
absolutely
to Mulligan for a Secret Paladin and not the Face Paladin.
Mm-hmm. It's a very different dynamic in terms of the way that the deck plays out and the types of decks that are strong against it.
Right, so if you're looking at Miracle Rogue and wondering where did that happen again, it briefly had a resurgence on Ladder for about a month before people realized this is a very fragile deck, especially with the six-man Auctioneer, but Coleman still has it in his arsenal to go forward. Not going to do that quite yet. He's going to go Freeze Mage into what appears to be either Control or Patron Warrior.
Grom doesn't really mean much of anything, but just Armor Up means a lot in this matchup in general. The Freeze Mage deck is very much dependent on getting through damage and finishing the game in a burst, and just armor makes it very difficult.
Right, now some things to note. Since the Warsong Commander change, Patron has gone under a slight redesign, and most players actually use it as something of a mid-range deck now. So what that means is a lot of the cards like Shield Block that were based purely on like card draw and cycle have kind of been cut, so there aren't actually that many methods of armor generation. It's usually on Armorsmith to do the work of generating the armor, so you actually won't see it played very often on turn two because you want to save it for Patron.
And we
combos.
See exactly that just now. We see Diggin choose to armor up rather than play as Armorsmith. The idea is that you can get your Armorsmiths on board later on when you've established a significant minion presence and then generate a lot of armor from something like a Whirlwind.
Right. It's a little bit of good news for Coleman that Diggin is playing that Patron Warrior, which is slightly better than the Control Warrior would have been.
Yeah, Control Warrior has access to cards like Justicar Trueheart, cards like Shield Block, Shield Maiden, that make it very difficult for the Freeze Mage to really ever close out the game. And also, the board clear effects are actually quite strong against Patron Warrior, whereas they're quite weak against the huge minions that Control Warrior typically plays.
Yeah, Justicar especially. If you play ladder and you just see that hit the board on turn six, I've seen so many people just
many opponents just actually
away.
Just, yeah, well yeah. played, concede.
To me. So, as a Freeze Mage player, knowing at this point that you're up against Patron because you've seen the unstable ghoul, how do you try to find a way to win this game? What is your approach? Savige, what do you got?
Either you try to end it really quick. I think that there's actually more to consider about from the point of view of the warrior. Like, the warrior has different game plans. Warrior can go for the fatigue from the beginning, just getting those armor ups as much as possible. Maybe then battle raging for zero. I've seen people do that successfully. But from the mage point of view, you need to go off as fast as possible with all of your fireballs and try to end the game as quickly as possible.
Ryan, what do you think?
I don't play Freeze Mage. I don't know from that perspective. I do know that from the perspective of Patron, which I have played quite a bit, there are a lot of people who think that you know they just want to armor up every single time it's an opportunity. But I think that's actually kind of a mistake in this matchup because you don't have those additional armor gaining tools. And it is possible, particularly with a big Emperor into Antonitis turn, for the Freeze Mage to generate enough damage that they can kill you even through pressing that armor button. So you do want to use your resources to put some amount of pressure on them as well.
Yeah, I think it kind of depends on the starting hand quite a bit. I've seen many, that might sound a little bit obvious, but that's not so obvious to everybody. I've seen it since some players just like decide, okay, from turn one, I'm going to armor up as much as I can, and just decide to go with that game plan, even if the hand doesn't support it.
That draw from Diggin right there is kind of funny, actually, because he has the best possible hero power against Freeze Mage, which is armor up, and playing Sir Finley would make him lose that.
Yeah.
We actually had a bit of discussion prior to the event, where I was talking about how I feel like Sir Finley is a card that's kind of overplayed, because I think that many decks will have Sir Finley in them when maybe they just don't necessarily have the best use of their hero power, but this is an instance where it's actually actively bad to play Sir Finley.
It's true, but this is an extreme example
Absolutely,
of that.
For sure. Yeah.
This is also one of those things, I too was playing a lot of Patron last month, and when I would come into this matchup, I would basically say, all right, Finley, you're in my hand until we get to Fatigue, and then you play him down, and then you just start finding ways to do direct damage in Fatigue, so then you pick up your Steady Shot, then you pick up your Fire Blast, and there Finley can shine, but totally agree. Playing it now is just akin to basically throwing the game.
Yeah, back into this actual game, I think that Golemon's hand is looking quite all right. It's not perfect, but there's a lot of card draw, maybe even more than he would like to have, and there's Antonidas with the coin, so if he finds Emperor Torisson, he will be able to generate a lot of fireballs for very little mana.
Yeah, and this is sort of what we were talking about. Coleman he's been able to assemble a lot of these powerful cards in his hand because Diggin hasn't really had him under pressure. Diggin hasn't used his mana to play things like that Shredder in his hand. We've seen him play pretty reactively to what Coleman has played, and now he doesn't have the board presence to actually remove this Doomsayer. Yeah. There wasn't even a Frost Nova, but still, there's nothing he can do to actually get this off the board. He's actually looking like he may lose his Armorsmith without getting a single armor from it.
This is absolutely huge. Armorsmith is one of those most painful cards for Freeze Mages to deal with. And I know that a lot of Warrior players in this particular matchup also like holding on to their Armorsmiths and then drop them on the same turn as they use a lot of Whirlwind effects. Yeah. But here, wow, even the Shredder into that. The Ghoul is going to into Death Rattle first, so the Shredder Pilot will not take the damage, but still only going to have that... only gonna have that random two drop afterwards.
And this may seem very confusing to a lot of players that yeah he just played a creature into a Doomsayer, but I have to imagine that what he's doing is just trying to hope to get some sort of tempo on the board because he has use for his mana over the next couple of turns, and he doesn't see a place where he's going to play that piloted Shredder, so he's hoping to maybe get a good drop off the Shredder.
Right, and it's very easy to, as someone who may not necessarily know this matchup, the ins and the outs of it, look at kind of the olden days of Grim Patron and think, oh, you win because you just generate a bunch of armor. The problem is you're not generating as much armor as you used to, so you really have to pick your spots with Armorsmith, and you have to combine it with Grim Patrons, Whirlwinds, Deathspite procs, and all these other things, because when something like that happens and you get no value, suddenly this matchup becomes a lot more favored for the Freeze Mage.
Yeah, I mean, looking at this game right now, Coleman is in a dominating position.
Yeah.
Diggin has very few resources left. We've talked about that Sir Finley being actively negative for him to play. And Coleman has lots, he's been able to assemble a lot of card draw, He, you know, has Archmage Antonitis, which is what will give him the tools to break through any big armor gain Diggin is able to put forth.
Yep, Golemon's hand is really good. Those Blizzards, maybe not so effective, but still, just the Antonitis and the coin. Unless Alexstrasza and Emperor Torisan are both at the bottom, I would actually expect Golemon to take this one, maybe, in the long run.
Yeah, this one, compared to the Control Warrior Freeze Mage matchup, is way friendlier for the Freeze player, Freeze Mage player. So I agree, he's in a very good spot, has a bunch of removal options. And the thing is, winning this game as the Patron player is never about winning off the back of Patrons. The reality is, between Doomsayers, Blizzards, Flamestrikes, you're probably just never going to get to build that perfect board that you would build against, say, like Midrange Hunter, against Sneaker Paladin. So because you're not going to be able to do that, the win condition is to stall out and make your opponent run out of resources. And as we're seeing, it's just not happening. Like, Colemon has everything he needs.
Yeah, we actually saw, it was actually fairly early in the game, we saw the interaction that I think kind of colored the pace of how this game played out. On turn four, Diggin ended up killing his opponent's Acolyte. Because he had a Stable Ghoul in play, he didn't want to give his opponent a bunch of extra cards. That was instead of playing Piloted Shredder. So he ended up like not having a significant board presence as a result of not actually getting that Shredder into play, which left Colemon really with very little threat to react to and allowed him to build up this strong hand.
Yeah, and this is actually, I'd like to get your guys' opinion, starting with Savij. Playing the Piloted Shredder into the Doomsayer, obviously that leaves you with something on the board, but maybe in this situation you're not in necessarily as big of a rush as other decks are, so what do you guys think? Do you think playing on the Piloted Shredder makes sense into the Doomsayer?
Personally, I think that actually like kind of accomplished nothing. He was so low on cards anyway that even if the 2-drop is at, let's say, 3-2, he can't really follow it up anyhow. And here, this is interesting, because Diggin seems to be going for the strategy that he would burn one card from Golemon. So if that is maybe an Alexstrasza or Emperor, but he drew both of them
right before. And that was a little bit of an unfortunate situation for Diggin there.
That was akin to baseball where the runner is safe. Like, you just see the safe just barely slides over home plate, but Thorasan and Alexstrasza both in the hand, and Loot Hoarder, fine, take it. I don't need it.
Yeah. One of the worst cards. He probably didn't want that Loot Hoarder. He just got rid of it.
Just slow him down.
Yeah.
He just wanted the next card. But there, we do see, in a lot of situations, some players will go really hard into trying to force their opponent to burn cards where possible. And against Freeze Mage, it's actually one of the situations where I think it is a viable strategy, particularly when you are kind of behind, like Diggin is now. Diggin needs to try and get lucky and hope that he can eliminate one of the key individual legendaries in Colemon's deck.
Yep, unless we see an Iceland Straw, I would expect the Alexstrasza to hit the board first here. I'd be too surprised if he just went for the Emperor. He does have a full hand, but I kind of like the Alex a little bit more. But maybe you'd rather have the Emperor Executor.
I think I like Alexstrasza better here. I think overall,
just uses your mana.
Yeah, I think uses so your mana. Too. You play Big Dragon. It doesn't immediately get contested. If there's no Execute in Diggin's hand, you pretty much just win right there.
Because Icelands would basically be a free Fireball later on if he gets the discount on that. And the second Frostbolt, pretty much the same case.
Lothab is a powerful card in this matchup at times, but right now, I mean, you might stall him for like a turn, but you yourself are not putting together anything substantial, and the health total is more than reasonable for Colemon.
I mean, Diggin, he has no threat. You know, there's no real pressure here. Colemon is effectively 32 with block and barrier up, and you know he can't wait on Lothab and hope to get a great window for it. But at the same time, if he plays Lothab now, he's not going to be able to react to some of the powerful turns Colemon will have later. He's going to really struggle to win this game.
Yeah, this is going to be a rough one for Diggin. And there's the Iceland, so now the
Emperor.
It's so good, even with the coin. So next turn, he could actually go Antonidas, coin, Frostbolt, Iceland, and one of the fireballs, right?
Because
that's 11 mana.
He could basically do it all.
Yeah, so he can even cast one of the fireballs that he draws. That is so incredible.
As much as I'm not a big fan of necessarily watching Freeze Mage play because it's a little bit slow for my taste, I gotta say, when all the spells come together and you just see them flying out of hand, you see the Frostbolts, the Ice Lances, the Fireballs, feels so good. Savij, you look like your face is gonna explode. What?
I'm really happy to see that the Freeze Mage does stand a chance against the Warrior, because often it's so one-sided.
The funny thing here is that Colemon will actually burn a card if he plays Antonitis first, because he has 10 cards at hand and everything he's gonna play after his spells. So if he wanted to coin first and give up a random card on the top of his deck for a fireball. But here he just, no, I want those fireballs. I want to burn everything.
Yeah, let's go.
I think he's pretty okay with this. And I have what is
I
this?
I can't imagine why.
Well, you know, Ryan, I'm not a great Hearthstone player, but I will say that a lot of fireballs generally good for your cause.
Five fireballs. Five extra fireballs. He already had one in his hand, too.
And this is exactly what I was talking about at the beginning of the game when I was saying that armoring up every turn, it's not good enough. How many times do you have to press armor up to beat seven fireballs or whatever it is that Coleman has?
A lot of math.
It's too many. You know, it's actually six fireballs in his hand so far. Sorry. It's only six. It's only, you know, only 36. You have to armor up 18 turns? Yeah, it's just not going to work.
Well, yeah. Dingin doesn't have that long as the game is over. Yeah. He's going to go ahead and concede, and Coleman's going to go ahead and get the tie on this. And that is one of the matches, I would say, more so than any other, is rooted in technical play. Mm-hmm. You have to really understand your lines of play to win that one. You can't just play Patron like you normally would. It's this mid-range matchup, because that, in that respect, Freeze Mage will just destroy you, because that's what it does.
There are a lot of elements of it that can come down to individual card choices as well. We did see the Harrison Jones and Finley in Diggin's deck, which are not particularly standard in Grim Patron. If, for instance, one of those may have been Crowcrown Elite, which is another card that sees play, maybe he could have killed that Doomsayer. You know, there are a lot of individual tech decisions that can make that matchup better and worse as well.
I think there were also some turns where Diggin could have potentially taken a different line, like maybe not play the Armorsmith that early, or play the Shredder early on, or not play it later on. There were some small things that could have been different, but Coleman had the draw that he needed, and I think he played it flawlessly.
Yeah, Coleman definitely understood what he needed to do to win the matchup. You know, his opponent generated 9 extra armor, sure, but he was able to assemble so much damage that it just didn't matter.
Right, and we're going to go ahead and hop into game 3 here, and we see Warrior on Warrior. And I want to think, based on the Taskmaster, that this is Patron for Coleman. Although, you know, obviously there's a long period of time where we did see the Cruel Taskmaster in Control Warrior, so not totally outside the realm of possibility.
Well, there's an Interrage.
Interrage, yeah.
I was predicting it based on the lineup, too. It just seemed to make so much more sense to be playing Patrons with a Rogue and a Freeze Mage.
And this is another matchup that can hinge pretty heavily on specific deck building decisions. That Harrison Jones that we saw from Diggin could be very important in this particular matchup.
Dr. Boom. You don't see that in every single Patron list, but I guess most of the lists do have it.
It's pretty common nowadays, since most of the Patron lists try to play more as a mid-range minion-based deck rather than any kind of combo-based deck. Typically have Boom and likely Grom as their sort of top-end finishers.
Yep.
This is, despite being a Patron v Patron, it's shaping up to be a pretty slow game. Neither player has actually done anything just yet.
It might speed up a lot if Diggin picks up an Inner Rage, because with that Death Spite, he could go off with the Patrons on turn 5 and create 4 of them.
This is one of the situations where it suddenly gets very hairy when you have the coin. He can play down the Shredder now, but that means he won't be able to get out the Death Spite now or Patrons on turn 4. And conventional wisdom tells us that in this matchup, he who patrons first doesn't have to patron last because he wins.
Quite often that is the case. The first player to create 4 patrons is usually going to be the winner. Not always, but...
Here, though, Diggin has no real way to enable the patron in his hand. He doesn't have an Inner Rage, he doesn't have a Whirlwind. So I think that he just wants to try and play this sort of as a normal minion-based game right now, where Pilot of Shredder is quite strong.
Yeah, I mean, he does have the Death Spite, so that gives him the... the whirlwind effect, so it's just an Inner Rage. Could be enough. Coleman on the other side, he has an Inner Rage and he has the Death Spite set up, but he's lacking the Patron right now.
Every time I see that Bloodfin Raptor, I have Stranglethorn Veil flashbacks from when I was questing and WoW. I'm like, I don't want to be in that zone, it's so big. But as you guys pointed out, if Diggin were to have played the Death Spite last turn and swing, he would have obviously had the ability to Whirlwind for and make one other extra Patron, but that's really not what you want to be doing this match.
No.
You want at least 4 Patrons before you go off.
It's usually the best thing is to have 4, because if you make 6, it's sometimes your opponent can maybe damage them evenly and just take them out.
Right. There's also always a danger where your board is full and you actually can't make more patrons, so you end up losing on patrons. There's a lot of very complicated patron math.
It's the embarrassment of riches. I have too many patrons. Oh, God.
All right. We're going to have to lay off some of you guys. We're cutting back.
This bar is at capacity.
Everyone go home. Yeah. So, Coleman, I don't think this is an easy turn by any stretch of the imagination. If you play down the Acolyte, yes, you get more card draw, but you always run the risk of you're not putting down that big threat that Diggin immediately has to address. So took his time to really think it over, ends up playing the Acolyte of Pain. He's going for the card draw. He can get rid of the Bloodfin Raptor if he wants to, but that is giving up a really important tool for this matchup.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, certainly. I don't think you want to use the Inner Rage, but I wouldn't be too surprised if it did. But I like keeping it here, because if he finds a Whirlwind and a Grim Patron, that Inner Rage is going to play a big role.
So now Diggin did pick up a... No, for some reason I thought that was a different card. he picked up a Berserker for the turn, which is probably not what he's looking to do here. He does have the Grim Patron, so if he does find any other way to enable that, he will have, if he plays Death Spite attacks, the ability to generate multiple patrons next turn.
Right, and I do want to point out, because of the slow start of this game, Diggin actually never damaged himself. So if he does Battle Rage, digging for that Whirlwind, digging for that Whirlwind and that Inner Rage, I'm done. I won't ever use that again. He won't actually be able to draw two cards. He'd only draw one, so.
Wow, and this is a very aggressive line from Diggin, choosing to use his Execute effectively to do four damage to Coleman here. He went to play the Death Spite and did not attack his opponent's acolyte. He decided to use a resource in the Execute just to go four damage to face.
Yep. An interesting line.
It does also prevent a card draw, however.
Yeah, slam into unstable ghoul looks kind of tempting, but then your opponent might use it against you, so probably not a good idea.
And we see Coleman has the Whirlwind and the Inner Rage. Diggin has the Patron. If they could just work together.
With their powers combined,
they have a board full of patrons.
Yes. Captain Patron, is that what it is?
Ooh, don't necessarily know that's a hero I necessarily want to get behind. See, so that comes out a turn later. That's interesting. You know, he roped out, basically trying to figure out whether or not to Inner Rage that Bloodfen Raptor. At his HP total, he's just like, fine, the Raptor has to go.
Ooh, the Inner Rage from Diggin. That is a huge draw there. It does enable him to get the Patron train rolling. And suddenly, there's a lot of threat on Diggin's side of the table. He takes out the Shredder. What's in the box?
Four patrons hit the board, and Diggin is now in a commanding lead.
Right. Diggin's really hoping these patrons are going to help carry him to the Europe Winter Championship next month.
Yep, and they just might at least carry him to 2-1 lead at this situation. Coleman still doesn't have his own patron, and
he has a lot of ways to make patrons for Diggin, though.
Yeah.
It's a lot of whirlwinds.
It's true. How much of this can he actually clear? There's no way for him to clear everything, right? Because there's no weapon. Killing those full health patrons is impossible for as it is.
Yeah, he has no way to actually get a three health patron off the board.
Wow. Could he like try to fill the board first somehow? I don't think so.
I was gonna say, I was looking at that and I don't think he could actually accomplish anything with that. He would also give up so many resources trying.
Yeah, that's also true. I'm like, if he whirlwinds first, then no, that's just, no. It's madness.
He could slam one of them and then Whirlwind, it'll only generate one more patron since the board will be full.
And this is where, yes, this deck is absolutely a mid-range deck, and then suddenly it's patrons.
Yeah. Well, that's the strength of the deck is that it can play in so many different ways. In some matchups, you're actually just a control deck. You're just playing defensively and trying to grind out your opponent's resources, gain armor with Armorsmith, things like that. But you have the tools to just close things out. And speaking of closing things out, it looks like Diggin has
that's
just
18
enough.
For sure.
It is, in fact, 18 for sure. Exactly lethal. And Diggin will go up to a 2-1 lead in this matchup.
Coleman has the face of a man who had all the tools to make patrons and never the patrons to make patrons. And unfortunately for him, that's going to translate to a 2-1 lead for Diggin. Diggin is one game off of securing that fourth spot in the championship next
year. That Dr. Boom there in the end might look a little bit silly to some, but I actually like it. I think that was his only chance to get back into the game. Hope that his opponent doesn't have the last Death Spite or the Chromage to end the game. So
a lot of times players will look at situations like that and they'll be like, oh, well, if this, you died next turn. And it's like, well, I'm in such a disadvantaged position that what matters isn't whether I can survive the next turn. It matters if I can win the game. You know, I need to set myself up to win, not to, not lose the next turn.
Right, as we pointed out, he could have thrown a bunch of resources at possibly trying to do something with the board, but there was no guaranteed clear, and as far as we saw, there was no way to even throw a couple whirlwinds in there, throw slams to fully clear the board, so I completely agree with you. Putting down the Dr. Boom was really the only option that I feel like he had.
Yeah, it was desperate, but maybe with some slightly lucky boom bots, something could have been done still.
Yeah, that's one of those things where you're trying to make patrons on the Dr. Boom boom bots, you're like, all right, let's just hit for all one right. or two guys, let's just calm down. And a lot of times,
want them to hit your minions, but then it's like, no, just be gentle. Just be gentle, Boombot.
Right, so now Coleman knows going into this that Diggin just has to win with his Warlock deck, so he goes ahead and goes with Rogue, and we can see Diggin is playing that version of Zoo that is predicated on having a lot of minions on board, playing Sea Giant. I would not even be surprised to see Reliquary Seeker here.
Yeah, the introduction of Reliquary Seeker really kind of created a new version of the Warlock aggro deck that's more about just flooding the board and generating individual large minions like Sea Giant and Reliquary Seeker rather than having things necessarily even like Doomguard. Some of them don't even play that.
Yeah, I'm wondering if this is actually the first time at this European Winter Championship preliminaries that we see this type of Zoo.
I believe that it's the first time we've actually seen a Sea Giant on camera. And yeah. To be fair, it's possible that it's just a fairly typical aggressive Warlock deck that happens to have Sea Giant. The inclusion of Sea Giant is actually one that that comes up pretty frequently in otherwise standard decks.
Right. Yep. Now, I remember back in the day, Miracle used to have a fairly good matchup against Zoo. Obviously, times have changed with Gadgets and Auctioneer costing more and the construction of the deck just being different. But, Savij, as someone who played a lot of Miracle, would you like to walk us through how that matchup generally looks?
I would play the Miracle every time. I think it's quite a good matchup, actually. Deacon is looking at the solid 1-2-3 here, but all of those are kind of low. Low damage, and if cuts like Blade Flurry can be so devastating for the Zoo player.
Yeah, right now, Diggin, he has some relatively resilient minions. For instance, nothing right now just dies to SI Agent. But his minions aren't actually putting on a lot of pressure.
Yeah.
He's only dealing one damage a turn with each of those minions. The Imp Gang boss that he's going to play next turn is one of the bigger threats, though, early on.
Yeah, I mean, the fact that these minions are sticky also means that they are not so powerful right now. They don't deal that much damage. If they were both powerful and sticky, I guess they would be too good.
Kind of like Imp Gang Boss. Imp Gang Boss, it doesn't do that much damage for a 3-drop. It's only 2. But
Imp Gang Boss is as good as Imp Gang Boss needs to be. It's one of those cards that actually super frustrates me when I'm playing against Warlock. But we saw
Whoa,
it last turn.
That was a great draw.
Or is it? There's an Iron Peak Owl waiting.
It looks like a great draw.
It looks like it certainly does.
It's very appealing draw, we'll say
oh,
that.
Oh, no. Because if I was Colemon, I would go for the huge Van Cleef right now. With the coin, Deadly Poison, prep up, he can make a 10-10 Van Cleef, and if there was no Owl, the game ends right there, trust me. But as it is, there is that Owl. Let's see if he goes for it. He might just play
he
it.
He might just make the 6-6, possibly. Yeah, he may just attack
possible,
and
yeah.
coin out Van Cleef.
It's possible, but I'm pretty sure he's going for the big one. Oh, man. The Iron Peak Owl is going to be such a heartbreak for Colemon.
As Iron Peak Owl tends to be, that's kind of its thing. Breaking someone's heart.
Savij, I want you to remember, you told Colemon to trust you. Right? You said, trust me, this is going to work out, and Colemon will remember these words. What's that? Is that a hoot?
And then there's the sergeant, even if he wants to kill it right away. Even get the tutu body off the table.
Oh, that's just like rubbing it in.
we just see it in Colemon's face there. Yeah. That is Sestol. Exactly the card he did not want to see.
Why did I trust Savij?
No. But you have to go for it. Because it's so powerful. And usually Zoo is only playing one Owl. And not only that, but it's not a card that you keep in the starting hand. So it was also kind of unlikely that Diggin would have had it.
Congratulations to Diggin's friend who just reached Legend.
Congrats, Diggin's friend. Good job. Now, Colemon has exhausted so many resources. He had such a large, Colemon has exhausted so many of his resources, had a large hand, a lot of options, and now he's sitting on this very clunky hand.
And this hand is, he can deadly poison to SI, but he doesn't have any way to otherwise enable combo because he used so many of his enablers building that giant Van Cleef.
And for the record, as much as we're harping on that Van Cleef play, I really liked it too. Because
Absolutely.
If the Zoo player had no answer, and we've seen this a number of times, I remember I've seen Firebat do this as well. If they just don't have an answer, your giant Van Cleef is really big and just punches them to death.
Yeah. 10-10 is hard to beat.
Yeah. It ends the game quite quickly.
I mean, we have seen Iron Beak Owls come through in really clutch situations throughout this tournament, from silencing Doomsayers to silencing your own minion to get freeze off and go fade, any number of things. It's clearly a very, very powerful card.
Right. If there is going to be an MVP to the preliminaries, we're definitely going to want to get that interview. Have Dan interview Iron Beak Owl and see his thoughts on the matchups.
I think his thoughts are, hoot, hoot.
Colemon taking his time here because there really just is not a good play to be had. He may just have to actually tempo out an SI agent, but that trades so poorly for him.
It's true. It's really bad. He was considering the deadly poison, I believe, but the 5 attack weapon doesn't really serve any purpose as it is.
It can kill an Imp Gang boss.
I mean, yeah. But yeah, that's not so good.
Diggin has a couple of options of his own here, actually. He can go with the implosion and see what he gets. All right. It's a four. When it rains, it pours. Implosion for four there for Diggit. He is in a pretty dominating position now. Kolomon does have Sludge Belcher, which is a good response to this board, but can't really be feeling particularly good about the state of this game right now.
Yeah, I'm wondering if it could be possible that he would just like hero power pass here, to let his opponent have a full board, not be able to play anything more next turn.
That's a reasonable option. I mean, he'd be taking, what, eight damage?
Yeah.
And he's at 12. That's pretty scary
it
spot
is,
to be
it sure
at.
Is.
I was going to say, meanwhile, on the Zoo side, it's just business as usual. It's like, well, I didn't gamble really hard, so I'm going to sit here and just play minions like a Zoo board should.
That power overwhelming from the top, excellent draw, allows him to dig and to take out that Belcher quite easily, and with the remaining five mana also, he can play the Egg and the Imp King Boss, and this is really one-sided right now.
This is just purely why that not like this Twitch emote was made. Just these are our dark moments, and again, big risk, big reward to the play from Kolomon. And Kolomon's by no means has he lost it yet. He's actually not facing down that much damage yet. But next turn we see the Dr. Boom. So if he plays down the Thorzan, Diggin can trade minions in that, get the full value from Dr. Boom, and it's a bad time to be a rogue.
It sure is. Dr. Boom is one of those cards that you just never want to see as a rogue player.
Oh my
player.
God! And then there's the Sea Giant too.
A wealth of options here. We see he could just play the Sea Giant.
It's actually an interesting spot, yeah.
Yeah.
He actually doesn't have room for Dr. Boom and the Boom Bots. He probably wants to trade into this Emperor, though. Emperor is a sort of card that if something can go wrong, it's kind of likely it involves Emperor from this position.
Right.
I think we did see that Kolomon had the Auctioneer, and allowing a deck with Auctioneer and Malagos most likely to get multiple ticks off of Emperor, it can lead to disaster. Speaking of disaster, that's just what this turn looks like for Kolomon here. He doesn't really have any particularly great plays at all. He can play his own Boom. He'll make essentially free Sea Giant for Diggin, who can then just trade in and force damage.
Yeah, that preparation from the top was certainly not what Kolomon was looking for. Absolutely
This is just lethal damage, I believe, at this point. There it is.
And that is going to be the series for Diggin. Takes it 3-1 and secured that final upper bracket spot at the Europe Winter Championship next March 18th through 20th, and really well played. Kolomon took the gamble, really wanted to close out that game quickly. Obviously didn't have the Gadget Day and Auctioneer in hand, so there's nothing suggesting there was going to be a mid to late game, but the Hoot Hoot once again, Ironbeak Owl, MVP of the prelims, doing work.
Yeah, I mean, I'm happy for Diggin, but at the same time, I'm kind of sad for Kolomon because of that Auctioneer deck. I really wanted to see those Gadget and Auctioneer preparation turns.
He's still in it. You know, this was the upper bracket. While Diggin does move on to the championships guaranteed, Kolomon still has his shot in the lower bracket.
Yeah, so speaking of that, we now have top four. We had Dr. Hippie, Prokhorovac, it was Nick Slay, and now we have Diggin, our four upper bracket members traveling next month to the Winter Championship. But now we head to the lower bracket to see who the other four players will be joining them coming up here in a bit. And, you know, there are some big names left in there. There's one or two. We obviously recognize Crane is kind of one of the better players, as well as Nyman, who is fairly well-known in the Hearthstone community. Any thoughts on if these two can possibly make it through, Savige?
Oh, absolutely. Both of those guys are excellent players, and I'm sure that the unknown players still in the lower bracket are also very good. Mostly, like, every single game that we've seen, or every single match that we've seen today, eight relatively unknown players, but they've all been playing excellent.
We've actually seen, while they may have been unknown, I believe it was four of the eight players who were playing off for the right to move on were practice partners of one another. So it's clearly not a coincidence that these players who worked together and had similar strategies had success. You know, these aren't players who just happened to get to make it here. They worked hard, they worked together, and they solved the problem of the, you know, the decks and lineups they wanted to bring to this tournament.
Right, that's kind of an interesting point. You bring up practice partners and practice groups. I actually was just seeing recently, you know, Orange was talking about the fact that, you know, he practices a lot with SK Gaming, and there's definitely merit to having a group of people that you can bounce ideas off of, try these things in these practice environments, and not just be sitting there solo playing on the ladder or playing against one person, but really kind of helping to develop your own robust knowledge of the Hearthstone scene in general.
Well, it's important, particularly with the additional layer that the ban adds to the strategy of Conquest, that you're not just, okay, how does this deck do against this deck? How does this deck do against this deck? You need to be figuring out much more robust strategies, because you're playing a lineup against a lineup in a very meaningfully different way. So having players who you can bounce ideas off of, who can practice specific matchups with, you can practice changing specific cards with, it makes a big difference.
Yeah, and like the aggressive Paladin list that we've seen here, that's not a deck that I would expect would be doing so well on the ladder, but these players, in tournament settings have been doing very well. So it's possible they practiced for those best of fives and that type of things.
It's easy to play on ladder and sort of get the idea, oh, well, all of these decks I'm playing are good. I keep winning with them on ladder. It's like, well, that doesn't necessarily mean it's a good lineup for a tournament.
Yeah.
And you're not going to find that unless you're specifically practicing for a tournament.
You don't have a ban available in the ladder.
Exactly. People might like that, though.
Yeah, that's what I call the curse of the tempo mage. This is winning so much on ladder. I'm surely going to take
what
this tournament.
What could possibly go wrong?
Right. Speaking of things that can go right, though, we're going to go over to the host area and talk to Dan.
Smooth as top of your head, Rob, as always. So that wraps up our last quarterfinal to our winter prelims. We have 4 out of 8 players who are going to meet us next month, March 18th to 20th. And you know what? I mean, that's half the players, but yet again, we have people who are still just building their stories, which is ultimately what's so inspiring about it. And right now, we're joined online by the winner of the previous series to talk about how his series went down and his journey through the Winter Championship. So, Diggin, you're playing from Norway. Can you give more background on yourself? Because that's just we just know your name and where you're playing from, but tell us more about yourself.
Yeah, hello. My name is Diggin. I'm 21 years old, and I play for Gamers League. I started playing after release. My teacher recommended me the game, and yeah, he was pretty hyped for Hearthstone, so I decided to give it a try. And it was so much fun getting better, and now I'm qualified for BlizzCon.
That's awesome. I'm guessing you're much better than your teacher right now, right? Like, he was more of a casual type of fun player, and now you've gotten much better. You've surpassed your teacher.
Yeah, he doesn't like networking, so he creates his own stuff, and yeah.
Gotcha. Well, that's awesome, man. You know, your journey through here, the entire process, I mean, some people have come through all different kinds of backgrounds, too. What was your specific journey to get through here, through the ladder or through tournaments?
Oh, I played the mostly ladder. I got one top 50 finish, and I also won. I got third place in an online tournament, but I don't think I got that point.
Okay. Well, I mean, you still got it through. You got enough points, and now you're through. Did you expect to be able to go this far when you registered for the tournament?
No, I told my teammate that I was expecting to lose in the first round.
Oh.
That's I know how this game works, so yeah.
Well, I mean, apparently not completely how it works, because you're through to the next round. I mean, is that what's the most exciting thing now that you've qualified for the winter finals?
I don't know, going to LA, I guess. I'm going to LA, right?
Yeah, I believe the finals here are somewhere here. I don't think we have announced the venue just yet, but you get to be in nice, bright, sunny California.
Yeah, sounds good.
Awesome, awesome. Well, congratulations again. We usually like to open the floor to give you guys to say whatever you want at the end, like a shout out or a thank you. You said you had a teammate. Would you like to say anything for final words?
Yeah, thank you to Gamers League for helping me prepare. And shout out to Bunny Hopper as well.
Awesome. And you know what? It's Valentine's Day. Do you have any Valentine's Day shout out?
No, not really. I'm playing.
Not yet, but if you're winning Hearthstone games, maybe that'll change. All right. Congratulations, Diggin. You are our last person from the winner's bracket to go to the Winter Championships next month. And good luck in your journey to the Hearthstone Championships.
Thank you.
All right, guys, so that's 4 out of 8 that is done, but we still have a lower bracket to go through. I do have some more updates as well. We had a couple more players that I didn't mention. I actually browsed over it mistakenly. However, we did take a look at Crane through the lower bracket, and unfortunately, he has fallen as well just in the round of 32. So that means, I believe, outside of Nightman, we're pretty much exhausted here out of names that are familiar with, at least to us, the casters, which once again, we're going to get to know some more new players. Let us know what you guys think as well about some of these new players. I mean, people were talking about how much they're fun they were watching with Nick Slay and his crazy life coach / Raynad reaction hybrids of like crazy salt and whatnot. It was super fun. Tweet at us at playhearthstone and facebook.com/hearthstone. I'm Frodan. It's been so fun watching the games from this side of the tavern, but we're only halfway through. When we come back, more action for the winter prelims.